Hey there, I'm Dave Hearn, and I'm the director of Kissimmee Park Observatory. In this star hopping extra, we're going to continue on our basic astrophotography series and show you how to capture the night sky with your camera using the piggybacking method. More about all this great stuff right after this. Stay tuned. Hey, hello, hi, and welcome to episode 24 of Star Hopping with Kissimmee Park Observatory. I'm Dave Hearn, and I'm extremely gratified to be your host. In this series of programs, we'll show you the most beautiful sights in the night sky and explain exactly how to find them with your binoculars or your telescope. So tonight we're going to continue with our new topic area of basic astrophotography and continue to discuss methods of how to capture the night sky with your camera. The first episode about tripod astrophotography was pretty popular as star hopping episodes go, so we'll continue on with more information this time. In the first astrophotography episode, we discussed the three basic methods for taking an astrophoto, going from the most simple to the most complex. As a reminder, they are, number one, time exposures of the night sky using a fixed tripod, which lets you create star trails or time-lapse movies. We discussed this method last time. Number two, mounting your camera on a mount or telescope that is tracking the stars, otherwise known as piggybacking, which lets you take images of large deep sky objects, and this will be this week's topic. And number three, mounting your camera on the focus of the telescope, thereby using the telescope as a long telephoto lens. This allows you to capture smaller objects and get close-up images of deep sky objects. We'll discuss this one in a future star hopping astrophotography extra. So as I mentioned, piggybacking is a little bit more difficult than basic tripod astrophotography because it requires more equipment and you'll need to know your way around your telescope. In a nutshell, you'll need to be able to mount your camera and lens on top of the telescope tube to let it take a piggyback ride as the exposures are taken, hence the name of this configuration. In piggyback astrophotos, you won't be using the main telescope optics to take the image, you'll only be taking advantage of the mount's motion. The image itself will be captured by the camera and the lens, just as we saw last time for taking tripod astrophotos. So this all assumes that the telescope's mount has the ability to track the stars. Basically, that ability is based on a motorized clock drive that moves the telescope at the precise rate to match the east-west motion of the stars, which is 15 degrees per hour, 15 arc minutes per minute, and 15 arc seconds per second. This keeps the scope pointed in exactly the same place for an extended period of time. Telescope mounts with this capability come in two types. The first is an equatorial mount that has two shafts, one that is aligned on the celestial pole called the polar axis, and one that turns at a right angle to that motion called the declination axis. Here's an image of a basic German equatorial mount. Second is a fork mount that supports the telescope tube between two arms, but it's set up in a polar configuration, meaning the rotation of the base supporting the forks must rotate around the celestial pole. This is what an equatorial fork-mounted telescope looks like. So let's dive in and talk about equipment needed for this type of shot. I'll provide some links to some of these products in the show notes. For piggybacking, you'll need 1. A motorized equatorially mounted telescope. 2. A piggyback mount or camera platform on the telescope. 3. Your DSLR camera set on bulb mode to allow long exposures. 4. A camera lens of any focal length. Wide-angle lenses will allow you to take deep exposures of the Milky Way and constellation shots showing nebula. Using longer telephoto lenses will allow you to capture large-scale deep sky objects but require a bit more effort to use. 5. A digital cable release, an intervalometer, or a computer and software to control the exposure sequence. 6. An ability to adjust your scope's fine position. This can be in the form of mount adjustment knobs or a telescope drive system with push-button control. 7. A high-power eyepiece for your telescope to allow you to manually guide. A great option for this might be an illuminated reticle eyepiece, and I'll talk about that more in a bit. Those last two abilities are needed for when you're using a higher focal length lens, say 200 millimeter focal length or above. Okay, now that we know the equipment, let's talk about the setup. First of all, you need to mount your camera and lens on top of the scope and add the appropriate weight to counterbalance the camera. Telescope mounts have to be closely balanced to work properly. If you have an equatorial mount with a counterweight, you can either slide the weights further down the declination shaft or add weights until the system is balanced. How you attach the camera to the telescope tube varies with the scope. Very often the tube rings that hold the telescope tube have quarter-inch screws or holes to add screws to allow you to thread into the base of your camera. In the old days, I just drilled a hole through the telescope tube, inserted a quarter-inch bolt, tightened it down with a nut, and added a wing nut threaded on in reverse. Then I just threaded the camera body onto that bolt and tightened it down with the wing nut. There are better methods today, such as dovetail brackets like this one. If you're using a longer telephoto lens, sometimes the lens itself has a foot like this one that can be used to mount the lens to the scope. Then you can just attach the camera to the lens as normal. Bear in mind that these camera and long lens assemblies can be really heavy, so you may have to add a good bit of weight to counterbalance it. Make sure your telescope mount can handle this additional weight. Do all this initial setup indoors during daylight hours to make sure that everything is solid. Make sure your balance is perfect before going out into the field, or you'll have a frustrating evening trying to figure out why your scope isn't tracking or not staying in position. It might not be a bad idea to do a trial run in your backyard to make sure the combination of scope and camera balances in all positions and tracks stars well. When you do go out to your observing site, you'll perform the setup for your imaging session. The first thing to do when you set up your equatorial mount is to align the mount with the celestial pole near the North Star Polaris. There are very detailed ways to perform this procedure, and that subject alone would take an entire episode to discuss. But for an approximate alignment, you can perform this basic process. Orient your mount such that the German equatorial mount is zeroed, pointed up at Polaris with the counterweight straight down. With a fork mount, the tube will be aligned with the forks like this. Point your scope at Polaris so you can see it in a wide field eyepiece, then rotate the mount about the polar axis. Adjust the mount's base and polar angle until Polaris stays centered in the eyepiece as you roll the scope in right ascension. That'll be sufficient for piggyback photos. Now plug in your clock drive, find a star in the east, and make sure the scope is guiding well. If so, go ahead and attach your camera and lens, balance the scope as done previously, and then check tracking once again. Now you'll need to connect the digital cable release or intervalometer, or make the computer connection and get that all working. For piggybacking, I would really suggest the more automated approach and use the intervalometer or the computer as opposed to a manual digital cable release. If you inadvertently pull on the scope as you press that cable release button, it could move the scope and ruin the entire image sequence. Now you can select and find your target. Great targets for piggybacking are large deep sky objects like the Andromeda Galaxy or the Orion area. Frame up your shot, and if you have a zoom lens, tighten up that zoom so it doesn't change over the series of images you'll be taking. If you're taking a wider field shot with a wide angle lens, you're pretty much all set and can start the series of images. We'll get into that detail in a little bit. But if you're using a longer lens, there's a good bit more work to do. So starting off, it may be good to do some wide angle shots to get a handle on the whole process. It's significantly easier because you don't have to manually guide and can trust the clock drive to do its job. So this next bit is for using lenses of 200 millimeter or longer focal length and setting up your rig to allow you to manually guide on a guide star. Once you get your target all framed up in the camera, put a high power eyepiece in your telescope and see if you can see a star. If so, this will be your guide star you'll manually track during the exposure. If you can't immediately see a guide star, you'll need to move around a bit to locate one. Then you'll have to go back to the camera and make sure it's still framed up properly. If it's not, make the adjustment and try not to move the scope, otherwise you'll have to find the guide star again. This can be a lengthy and somewhat tedious process, but it's critical for longer telephoto shots. During the exposures, you may see the guide star drift a bit because of inaccuracies in the clock drive gears or if you didn't do a great job in polar aligning. You'll need to use your mount's fine adjustment knobs or electronic control buttons to counteract that movement. That's why an illuminated reticle eyepiece is great. This is a high-power eyepiece with a crosshair or grid etched onto a clear piece of optical glass within it. An LED illuminates the lines so you can see how much the star is moving. The crosshairs give you a reference point to allow you to notice the motion. One additional twist. that crosshair has to be aligned with the motion of the mount, meaning that when you move the scope in one axis, the star follows one line, and when you move it in the other axis, the star follows the perpendicular line. You may have to twist the eyepiece in the focuser to get this motion aligned with the reticle's crosshair. This whole procedure I've discussed is the basis of manual guiding, and you'll find out that there's an art to it, and it takes a good bit of practice to become proficient at it. So there are automated systems that allow a computer and a camera to optically lock onto a star, but that's definitely beyond the scope of a beginner tutorial like this one. We use an auto-guider system like this for our astrophotos at KPO. Okay, now that we're all aligned to the pole, have mounted our camera and lens and balanced our scope, have pointed to a target, and have found a guide star, we're finally ready to start our image sequence. Right about now, a cloud bank usually rolls in. So let's talk exposure durations. As in the fixed tripod tutorial we discussed a few weeks ago, we'll be making a series of exposures and we'll be stacking them in our image processing software at a later time. The individual exposures are called subframes and they usually last a few minutes each. The total integration time of the final astrophoto will be the sum of the lengths of the subframes. So let's say you have a 5 minute subframe and you do 12 exposures of 5 minutes each. You'll have a total integration time of 5 times 12, or 60 minutes, which is a 1 hour exposure. The reason for the short individual subframes is that sometimes bad things happen. There might be a gust of wind, or a cloud covers up your object and you lose the guide star, or an airplane flies through your frame, or even a fellow stargazer says, "What a cool setup," and shines their red light into your camera lens. Any manner of badness might occur, but you'll lose just that subframe. It'll be thrown out during the image stacking process, so it's your duty to try to get 12 good subframes, so it might require 15 or more to really get that total. So now you kick off your exposure, and you'll hear the shutter open. You'll start watching the guide star through your telescope's eyepiece, making slow, fine adjustments as you see any drift occur. Eventually, after an eternity lasting 300 seconds, you'll hear the camera shutter close. Take a short mental rest and then start the next exposure. Keep at this until you have the number of exposures you need. Congratulations, you've completed your first piggyback image sequence. So after your imaging run, you'll take the image data in your camera back home and use the imaging software like Nebulosity to stack and process the images. I'll give another tutorial on the stacking process in the coming weeks. After all this effort, what you'll come up with will be astounding if you had good tracking in the subframes. It's not unusual to get images like this taken in piggyback mode on the KPO reflector. Wow, I know that was a huge amount of information for one episode. You can go back and watch the tutorial a couple times to make sure you get all the details. So let's review what we've learned. We started out discussing the basic kinds of equatorial telescope mounts required for piggybacking. Then we talked about the 7 pieces of equipment you'll need to be successful. Then we investigated how to mount your camera and lens on top of your telescope and get the proper balance, which is a critical step and should be done indoors well ahead of your imaging session. Then we delved into basic polar alignment, then the process to frame up your target in your camera, and then how to acquire a guide star in your telescope's eyepiece. Finally, we went through the exposure series and touched on the final image processing. As you probably see, the complexity has gone way up from basic tripod astrophotography. So it's a lot of effort to get these beautiful piggyback astrophotos, but that makes the final results even more special and valuable to you, and it'll give you a lot of pride when you share them with your friends on social media. So that does it for this week's show. You can find the show notes on our website at kpobservatory.org/SH024, where you can comment and leave any questions that you might have. Well, thanks for joining us, and I'll see you next week in our episode of Star Hopping.
I'm Cassie, and I hope you've enjoyed star hopping around the Milky Way. We'll continue to bring you these video astronomy tutorials every week on Thursday, and in their podcast format on Fridays. They'll be designed to help you find deep sky objects that are up in the sky at the time we post them on the internet. The reason we create these videos and podcasts is to help beginning amateur astronomers learn the sky and get more enjoyment out of their telescopes and astronomy in general. If you have any requests for potential targets in the night sky that you would like to see us discuss, just let us know down in the comments section below, or on our website blog. Don't miss our free field notes for this episode, basically the script of the show, with all the images and star charts we use for our star hopping activities. You can get them for free at kpobservatory.org/fieldnotes. If this is the first time you're checking out star hopping, and if you found this video useful, please consider subscribing to our channel by clicking the big yellow button, click the thumbs up on the video, and please share this tutorial out to your friends who like looking at stars. Also, as I just mentioned, please feel free to leave any question or comment below, and we'll be sure to respond quickly. Please follow KPO on Facebook, where we post all of our astronomical digital images, and keep everyone informed about upcoming astronomical events. We'd love to hear from you to discuss all this great stuff up in the sky. All the links to these places in cyberspace, including our website, kpobservatory.org, can be found below in the episode notes as well. And finally, if you feel this video provides you value, and if you'd like to see more, please consider supporting us on Patreon, where for a small amount per video, you can support our efforts, and help us make even more great astronomy tutorials, just like this one. So bye for now, and thank you for watching, and we'll see you next time on Star Hopping with Kissimmee Park Observatory.